Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Creator of Christ and Spirit, God of life and blessing, you created all that exists. In Christ, you offer your redeeming love to every soul in every situation. So it is our greatest joy to unite by your Spirit in the community of your people, stretching throughout the generations all around the world in love. We join our thanks and praise to the voices of all your saints, both in heaven and on earth, who worship and adore you, saying together,
a blessing be the Lord, all wisdom and thanksgiving, all honor and power belong to you, O God, this day and forever and ever. Amen.
It is not because we fear you, O God, but because we love you and trust in your loving kindness that we confess our sins together.
God, have courage and commitment. We confess that we have not followed the path you set before us. Sin, comfort, and fear hold us back from fully embracing your gift of new life. Our anxieties prevent us from your goodness to your love. Forgive us, O God. Give us courage that we may be your saints in our own time. Faithfully follow Jesus, no matter the cost.
The day is coming where the home of God will be among mortals. God will dwell with us and we will be God's people. God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things will have passed away. Accept the newness you are offered in Christ and share that promise with others. Amen.
And he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Look taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for those who fear him have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. The epistle reading this morning is 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 13. You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day, so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaim to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you believers. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." My next reading comes to us from Revelation. This is our reading for All Saints. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell upon their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. And he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Time looks entirely different at different periods of our lives. There is the wait, and then right this minute of time spent in the hospital. There's watching your children's childhood, as the days can feel tremendously long and the years can feel tremendously short. There's the long stretch of time spent awaiting a call from a doctor after a serious test. There's the immediacy of close friendships that always seem to pick up right where they left off. And then there's trying to plan a maternity leave and a sweet baby girl changing all the plans by coming just the moment she decided to arrive. And then, there's attempting to live faithfully in a global pandemic, a time that warps itself around each individual's experience of isolation, overwhelm, pain, grief, and unfamiliarity, sometimes all of those at the same time. How do we hope, and how do we see beyond our own experience? Hebrews 11:1 says, "Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen." I find the expansive definitions of time in the original Greek of the New Testament to be helpful in understanding time's function in our lives. There is chronos time, the time that is marked by a clock or a calendar, and kairos, which is much less about linear time and more about timeliness, something happening at the very moment that it is meant to happen, sometimes referred to as God's time. Our scriptures today lift up different aspects of faith over time. The psalmist demonstrates faith by praising God's demonstrated provision in the past. In the epistle, we heard Paul lauding the faith of the community of Thessalonica in a very chronos way. Paul points to the way that he and his co-workers had been at work among them. In the gospel passage, the Beatitudes lift up the faith of those who prioritize God over worldly reward. Those whose lives point to belief that the kairos of God is making things right in God's own time. The poor in spirit, those who mourn, the meek, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And of course, our passage in Revelation lifts up the faithfulness of those who have come before us, those who have come out of the great ordeal, as it says. And they spend the rest of their existence in limitless kairos experience spent praising God. Especially in times of distress, faith can seem like a strange or elusive thing. It is, by definition, a trust in a promise without concrete evidence. To be assured in our hope can seem foolish. But the Bible has quite a bit to say about hope. Hope appears in the Bible 167 times. 15 of which, and this was surprising to me, 15 of which occur in Job, of all places. Job was a man who lost everything, all that he had, all of his immediate family. He wrestles with hope, whether or not hope is warranted, and his friends try to talk him out of hoping. Hope's also in the Psalms, not 26 times, as the Psalms provide poetic accounts of interaction with God over time, in good and in bad. Proverbs 10, verse 28 says, "The hope of the righteous ends in gladness, but the expectation of the wicked comes to nothing." Proverbs 13, 12 says, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a desire fulfilled is a tree of life." In Paul's letters, he often refers to the gospel promise of redemption as hope. In Jeremiah 29, verse 11, a verse that is commonly seen cross-stitched on walls or on pillows, we read, "For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope." Now, this is often quoted as motivational passage, and I know I've had it on the front of a Bible, as a way to find peace in God's desire for good in our lives. But do we really understand what is meant by that? Especially in our American context, it's easy to skew this heavenly design as a balm for our individualistic concerns. However, when we read it in the Hebrew, we read that the "you" at the end of "surely I know the plans for you" is plural. It's not a plan for a singular person, but for all of us. My first class in seminary was Biblical Hebrew, or Baby Hebrew, as our professor called it. And in it, we learned the importance of the point of view of a word. In English, our plural second person and singular second words are often interchangeable. Saying "you" is ambiguous. But my Hebrew professor, originally from North Carolina, helped clarify this by referring to the plural second person in our classes as "y'all." I see some head nods on that one. Now, as born and raised Midwesterner myself growing up in Ohio, at first I found this quite off-putting, frankly, and a little bit strange. But as we unraveled the bits and pieces of this beautiful and complicated language, I was grateful for the y'alls that truly did give a bit more insight into who it was exactly that were called, charged, and oftentimes reprimanded by God in the Hebrew Bible. In my preparation for this sermon, I came across the words of another Southern pastor, Methodist James Howell. He writes, In the South, God would say, the plans I have for y'all. The future, the hope God gives you, y'all, is for a crowd. It's for the community. It's for the nation. God called Jeremiah to speak God's word, not to this man or this woman, or just you or me, but to the nation of Israel during its most perilous time in history. God's plan for the people, one plan, not a thousand plans for a thousand individuals. So who is the y'all that God has plans for now? Could it be the church? Aren't we the y'all God promises to use for good, he says. God is not through with the church, the coalesced body of believers, who by the grace of God never lose their destined role for the sake of the world. God has plans for the church, and church is about being God's instrument, not whether it suits me or entertains me. I never go solo with God. My life in God's plan is interwoven with others in God's y'all. I do not therefore lose my individuality, but I finally discover when I find my proper place in the body of Christ. He concludes by saying, I don't even want to believe alone. I want to believe with y'all. I need y'all. When we are part of the body of Christ, that is the universal church, we experience God in a more expansive way. Through other stories and experiences, we can believe beyond what we are able to know and discover on our own. This is true in the present, but it's also a reflection of the legacy of faith that we have received. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13 says, all these died in faith without having received the promises. And from a distance, they saw and greeted them. Can we really take comfort in hopes that are not answered in our own lifetimes? How can we be anything but disappointed by unanswered prayers? How can we continue to trust God when things don't work out the way that we want them to? Theologian Reinhold Niebuhr once said, nothing worth doing is completed in our lifetime. Therefore, we are saved by hope. Nothing true or beautiful or good makes complete sense in any immediate context of history. Therefore, we are saved by faith. Nothing we do, however virtuous, can be accomplished alone. Therefore, we are saved by love. No virtuous act is quite as virtuous from the standpoint of our friend or foe as it is from our own. Therefore, we are saved by the final form of love, which is forgiveness. As together we acknowledge this All Saints Day, we give thanks for the legacies of many people who began the work that we seek to carry on. We acknowledge that God's plan is much larger than us, and with a much longer timeline than we will ever experience firsthand. And this is not an easy thing, but it is part of what faith calls us to. The unceasing song of hope does not end when we are no longer the ones singing it. To have faith is to trust in the promise that just as the blessings of our lives came from that which was only promised to those who came before us. Maya Angelou speaks of this slow-to-come hope in her poem, Still I Rise. These lines come out of the conclusion of the poem. She writes, out of the huts of history's shame I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain I rise. I am a black ocean leaping and wide, welling and swelling I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. That line, in the dream and the hope of the slave, haunts me. We, as children of God, come from a people enslaved. Our faith's origins are found among those slaves in Egypt, those aching for freedom, aching for the promised land they never lived to see. We are their dream and their hope. We are the harvest of that deep grief, of that desert wandering. After the familiar narrative of Jesus and the woman at the well, Jesus speaks to his disciples about the continuation of the kingdom through the harvest of believers that they themselves do not cultivate. In John 4, 34 through 38, we read, Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and complete his work. Do not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest. But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap for that which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor." The hopes of our hearts may not always come into fruition before us, but as heirs of salvation, workers in God's kingdom of harvest, our acts done in faith bring life to the hopes of those who came before us. We reap a harvest for which we did not labor.